See, the issue for me was that time was the minimal light and the focus. If there's no rehearsal, it has to be focused. I am allowed to shoot only 40,000 feet. Before that thing, everything has to be finished so that we cannot waste the film like a digital. He doesn't have a screenplay. He makes a lot of improvisation at the sets and the places and everything. That is his habit also. The minimum light, that means more lights means they will made them conscious this year shooting. We generally keep it in some places where I can hide the camera to get candid shots.
Before going on to make his own masterpieces, Shaji N Karun was G. Aravindan's most preferred cinematographer. Shaji N Karun had shot almost all Aravindan films. Their second work together, the second collaboration together, Thamp, which fetched Shaji N Karun his first national award for cinematography when he was in his 20s. Thamp will be screened at Cannes on May 21 as the inaugural film of the Cannes Classic section. What is the importance of this Cannes?
Cannes, according to any filmmakers, that is the final place like a sports fan for the Olympics. When you see that, finally, many of the filmmakers are discovered from there, Cannes, Fellini, Bergman, and many of the people, even in Hollywood, also was discovered from there. And their way of addressing it is more of I would rather call it as a world meeting place for the cinema. Like, you know, many cinemas that discuss with the different kind of, what we say, the language and their culture. Unlike Oscar, which is mainly meant for the English-speaking countries. Here it is for the world cinema. So naturally, like anybody like us, the filmmakers from India, getting a recognition or being there is much kind of a dream for all of us. Where that many of the films which I saw it at Institute, like Fellini and Bergman, you always see a tag there. It is a Palme d'Or winner from Cannes, which is, I would rather call it, the biggest event for the cinema every year. That's Cannes. And even I get introduced to many filmmakers in Europe, I say that I participated in Cannes or got a recognition at Cannes, then they will suddenly realize that I don't need any more further introduction on my career or anything as a filmmaker. It is a timelessness that shows. I would rather call it that after so many years, it was shot in 77, 78, it was censored. And so many years later, somebody calls this is as a classic in world cinema. Probably it turned out on a history of Indian cinema, but then the language that speaks, that cinema is Malayalam, which is a very proud moment for any Keralite for that reason. It's like getting a Nobel Prize.
You're one person who knows Aravindan so deeply, so intimately. So I would like to know, I mean, he's generally known as a person who is very silent. I mean, he doesn't really express himself. I would like to know how he would have reacted if he had known that his film would be screened at Cannes. Would he have been elated? Would he have been very expressly elated or something like that, having known him?
Yes. And he's also a very emotional person, but he's also a person which he don't express their emotions very easily. And I am sure this is the time for him to say that whatever he has done, he would have been elevated to an area. Probably he would have been speaking or singing Rabindra songs. Always when we get excited he sings Rabindra songs. And I am sure that he would have done this thing at this time, because I know that the music is also properly. And we always see him on the personal ground, that when he gets excited, he's singing Rabindra Sangeet and then move around, jump around, which is some of the areas which artists like him, us, or could able to witness on a personal level. I think the same image I recognize on this moment on him.
And so for me, Thampu, and with Thampu, Aravindan was trying to take his film forward, not through his characters, but through his cinematographer, through you. I didn't see any particular narrative arc, any dramatic arc, any traditional narrative arc for the film. It was a delightful collection of random moments in the life of a village that all of a sudden erupts, bursts into life with the arrival of the traveling circus. What was the brief given to you by Aravindan, and what were your challenges?
This is second film, not third film after Kanjuro Sina. And then
your second film.
Yes, my second film also for that. And generally, as a student from the Film Institute, we have a certain kind of way to address the cinema. And then the first thing is that you ask the director, what is the screenplay? I wanted to get the screenplay first. But he didn't give me the screenplay very beginning, because we talk a bit when we travel together, like, you know, finding locations for after the first film, Kanjana Sita, and during the editing, he and myself will travel in the train or bus. Or then during that time, we had nothing to speak except the coming project. And Thampu, he described. That means Mr. Rabindran, who is the, I call it Deviatan, and the General Pictures, who wanted to make a film on Valarthamurgangal, M.T. Vasudevan Nair, for that reason, he was committed to that. And he said that he wanted to remake film on that, not remake, to make a film on Valarthamurgangal. Then Arundhatan said, I called him Aravindan for the good reason that the idea of being as a more than a brother, as a somebody which I respect in a different sense. So he said, I'll make a film on circus, but in a different concept. He agreed on thing. Rabindran was more generous in many ways that and like a pop for the, what you call, Michelangelo for painting at the Vatican. And that understanding between them, he said, I have this budget, you make any film for that reason. That's how it started it. And then there was not much of, say, that how it is going to make it in a sense that there's no screenplay, nothing else. He said, we are making on the life of a circus people, and it has been helped by Sridharan Champat, who is again a person who writes on the short stories on the circus. And again, he's also a part of the circus people, originated from the Elashiri and the northern part, which is also again a French colonized place that time. And Thalassery, Mahi, and everything. So many people arrived there because of French. Again, it is a see that the film is again back in the French speaking place in Cannes. So it has a lot of, if you look at that way. And what, the real reason for me to see that I have La Strada in Institute as my study films. And then Fellini. And it also got a palm down there in Cannes. So the circus and then the idea of what is circus, and then the idea of the clarity of emotional presence which Fellini made into that. Fellini is also like Aravindan, no, he doesn't have a screenplay. He makes a lot of improvisation at the sets and the places and everything. That is his habit also. That's the way. There are many filmmakers like that, that they don't have a screenplay. They go to the location and make films like that. So probably he must have influenced by him also, probably. So he said, this is a kind of a circus. People and their life, and then the people, you know, a circus comes to a village, to a place where they have never, the villagers never had witnessed the circus there. The reason, again, back to how you portray it. And according to me, because of my education in the Film Institute in Pune, because then I need a kind of a personal view of how you address a cinema from the very beginning to the end through the director's point of view, which made me a little puzzled. But I know this is it. But finally, in the end of the day, while we landed at the Tirunavai for the locations, he said, this is the circus people, it is a touring. So I my impression on the circus tent was like La Strada, with the minimum people and lesser areas. And he said, this much of area. He said, how much is the area for me to light up? He said, on a finger point, he said, around, he said, this much. Which I have to believe that it must be a 40 feet or 50 feet maximum. When I went to the locations, and then I realized, and then it was something like 200 feet of diameter. With the, that means I don't have, at least whatever the lights I needed, I was carrying only something like 1/5 of the lights which I could able to think about it. And suddenly, because of the budgetary reasons, because already Riviatan said this is the cost, this is the film cost. Most of the time, the raw stock cost a lot at that time, black and white. And all other artists, like, you know, Narimuti, you know, Gobi, and the new people in the circus and all the villagers there who never witnessed a circus in their life, were around there. So I had to make a point, how do we address it from a director's point of view, what he wanted to do? Because I am also at that time, I think I was at the age of 25, 24 or something like that. 24, I think. Yeah. And then really I realized that because of my age, and suddenly out as a fresh graduate from the FTI, to do certain things in a different way to do for the Indian cinema was also in my mind, because as a cinematographer, I know that the learning process was a different for us, that you should not place camera as an evident form of camera, because the cinematographer's job is to say that should be hidden in somewhere, because film is more important, not the cinematography. Director's point of view is very important. I asked him what would be the best possible way to address that. But personally, I thought I'll see camera from the point of view of an innocent villager from that side.
What lingered after seeing the film was what can be called what they call a multitude of faces, the close-ups of a million faces, and also the abundance of expressions that you captured. And all those expressions, be it joy, wonder, concern, love, sadness, and all of this in its purest form, none of the actors seem to be conscious of the camera nearby. How did you manage to keep yourself and the camera hidden? How did you be so non-intrusive, like a ghost? How did you manage that?
Oh, that's a really a good question, in the sense that the minimum light, that means more lights, means they will be, made them conscious this year shooting. So for them, it was a general lighting for them. So in the tent, so to keep them. So, and they are also not aware what is a motion picture camera also. We generally keep it in some places where I can hide the camera to get candid shots, really, from the point of view. The first 3 days, random, we were shooting, keeping. And the people also got amused for a good reason that, you know, they were seeing the circus first time. So more than our area, they were more engrossed in their circus also. So they were not. So it was easier for me that their attention is not being drawn to the filming part of it, but for the part of the circus part. So it was some kind of goodness that we could able to manage. And then so many young people, children, old women and young women. And then we planted a lot of our own characters also there. And I can tell you a funny instant. In the end of the day, when the festival, the temple festival is happening, and in our then we have our own character as a police. So we dressed him as a police, and then we asked them to walk into the crowd so that I will candidly shoot him during the, because of the part of the shooting of the cinema story. And then suddenly I can realize the original police came there and arrested him. So that I can see. So he said, somebody is coming with their dress, and the original, they put him, and then I had to tell them, because of my long telly, I can see them from a place that he's been going, some 2-3 people fighting each other, and then he took him. Then I had to tell the ground people saying that there is an issue there. Then they went there and then said it was a shooting for the. So then they realized. But see, the issue for me was that time was the minimal light and the focus. Because anytime the character is moving, it has to be, if there's no rehearsal, it has to be focused. And that time, now the very well known cameraman is Kumar, is the camera attendant for me, and he was so perfect that way, the distance and everything. So we could able to manage and save a lot of footage because of brilliancy on the idea of the distance, and he always focused that. Otherwise, we lose the film, means then the budget issue is also there. We cannot, because I am allowed to shoot only 40,000 feet. Before that thing, everything has to be finished, so that we cannot waste the film like a digital. We cannot recoup, and it's also expensive. Well, actually, 1/3 of the budget goes to the raw stock that time. So it was very precious that time also. So many times, the focus point at the minimal light, because I had to shoot in the most widest aperture, which means the focus is very critical there also.
And so in this context, can I ask you one more specific question? There are certain very, what do you call, unforgettable little episodes within the film. For instance, the circus team going around announcing the start of the circus. You begin like a festival parade with drums and bands and placards, and the dwarf distributing pamphlets to people he sees along. And then we are shown children rushing towards this parade. And then we have people, villagers, women, men, old men, policemen, they're all reading these posters. And then we have these posters stuck on the village walls everywhere possible. And then there is a shot of this a herd of cows passing along a wall that is handwritten poster is stuck. And then finally, we have certain abandoned posters being blown about by the breeze. So my question is, well, was it part of the script, or was it a case where you randomly shot all these pictures and got all of this assembled on the editing table? How did this happen?
No, we shot a lot of things like, you know, as random, but many times in the morning time we'll get. To me, as a cinematographer, The morning light in particularly, say the sunlight that is appearing 7 o'clock in the morning is the best, because it gets the exposure on the highlight areas and shadow details also, because sun is not so strong. So we took a lot of candy shots in the morning time. We go there and then we shot it. These are the shots which we picked up without any help, and we picked up here and first beginning days, say around 10 days, within 10 days we could able to cover it. And artist Namburi was also the main helpful person for me. He was the art director for this film. So he also get up quite early morning. So we go there. And these are the shots which we taken, and without the knowledge of the director. That was a director edited by Ramesan with the support of him. And Isaac Thomas Kottagapalli was my assistant. And when he comes up in the early mornings and do that. And he also referred certain shorts, this will be good for that one, because since we come from the same school, we communicated a lot of things together for that reason. And then later the editor, in the end of it, that made the editor, and the film is made actually. Originally this film, any films are finally made at the editing table.
Well, this is one more curious thing that I would like to ask you. Because generally in the film, people are not camera conscious. People are not aware of the camera. But there are two moments when the characters, the old clown and the tightrope walker, the women, they talk directly to the camera. It doesn't really fit in with the natural rhythm of the film, because Aravindan normally let the film run wild. I mean, go as it pleases, and then suddenly exerts directorial control. Why was this stylistic thing used? Was it a stylistic?
No, that is Aravindan's point of view, because he also saw the last order and everything. And then we see that this is his style. And if you look at very clearly his point of view of this cinema as a what you call the cartoonist in Ramu, a lot of characters appeared in that level. So his look, and in his cartoon, you see Ramu and the Guruji, and look at the person at the pan shop. A lot of characterization is also there along with these people. No? Yes, that is there. So this area of looking at your camera and speaking and everything is directed. Because that worked out very well also, because of the reason. Two things. One was a candid without camera. The second one is the camera conscious.
And I cannot wind up this interview without asking you your personal relationship with Aravindan, because there is this legend which said that both of you didn't have to communicate with words. I mean, Aravindan wouldn't have to say cut or start to you. I mean, what was your relationship like? I mean, you said it was like your elder brother. I mean, or a senior. No.
See, one opportunity that I work with him was he's a painter, he's a musician, and he values visual images, such a great restraint. And he wanted to make experiments, unlike any other filmmakers, that they come with their 100% screenplay and then debate. I mean, they ruled the... So it was more or less a different way to understand. So our relationship also, I could able, since I was an employee there in the KSFDC, I could able to make one film only in a year. And then Aravindan always made one film every year also. So, and then during the editing, recording, mixing, and also we have a lot of opportunity to discuss what is the next one. So this is during the second film, third films were discussed more at that time. So we know what kind of quality he is looking for that level. That 1 year of incubation, we get it, because he never do the screenplay or anything. Even the letter after that, Kumati was taken. So that was also not much of screenplay for me. So, but the debate and discussions during this making of the films, or the previous film, or the next film, there were a lot of information we could able to gather each other. And that gives a lot of silent communications and what you call confidences and thoughtfulness. This is what we need. And many times the actors also, they say, had a difficulty when the professional actors comes. They start and cut when they, because they also, when they say start, they have an energy to start it. When they also don't know when to cut it. And because then they were saying that time the camera was making sound. So they know, realize, when camera is on, the sound of the camera gives them an idea that it is on. So that's why we tell you. And then it worked out well in the sense that later part of it, that the idea of that communications in different layers, different thinking, and then it assembled in a point where we could able to make cinema on a certain kind of chemistry. And even if I work with any other filmmaker, then they must have a screenplay fully, and then they know what is the fag end from the very beginning to the end. Like Hariharan, I have done Nagashadangal, Panjagni, and Sargam, or commercial film, even Panmarajan, I made. But I have a screenplay fully, so I know what exactly to do that. That's a different chemistry. And this year, being an absence in between, is also a greater way to address that vacuum into a kind of a visual language for both of us, which we agreed together. And it happened, and it must be a wonder or a magic, as it happened. That's what I can say.
Well, that's lovely put, sir. So let's hope that when the film is screened on May 21, Aravindan is singing his favorite Rabindra Sangeet. It was nice talking to you, sir. Thanks a lot, sir.